So this is lecture 3 of this course on analog MOS circuit design. And in this lecture, I'll be basically talking about the ID VDS characteristics in detail and the ID VGS characteristics of MOSFET. So in the last two lectures, what we have discussed is the basic property of a MOS device. And we have identified that this MOS device is acting as a four-terminal device, namely gate, drain, source, and substrate. And in most of the cases, we will be using the MOS device as a three-terminal device as of now. That means if I just want to show you the symbolic diagram of a MOS, which looks something like that. You have a gate, you have a drain and source. Source is identified by this arrow. So these are the three terminals. This one is gate, this one is drain, and this one is source. Apart from that, you do have a fourth terminal, which is known as the bulk or body or substrate. But as of now, we have just got rid of this bulk or body or substrate, in the sense that we have assumed that this bulk and the source, they are at the same potential. But gradually you will see that there are certain kind of circuits for which the body and the source, they are not kept at the same potential. And accordingly, we have to take into account certain second order effects. But that thing we'll be discussing later on. As of now, let us now try to identify the MOS as a three terminal device, having these three terminals like gate, drain, and source. Now, lecture 2, what we have derived is the ID VDS characteristics of a MOS device. That means if the drain to source potential is varied, then how does the corresponding drain current vary for a MOS device? So that derivation was discussed in the last class. So once again, let me just show you the derivation, the ID VDS characteristics graph. So this one is VDS, and this axis represent ID or IDS. Now, we have already mentioned that this particular graph is having two different regions of operation. Initially, whenever the VDS value is small, then it will follow a parabolic kind of behavior. This ID will follow a parabolic kind of behavior like this. And then it attains a peak, and then it remains constant. So this particular value of VDS at which the ID attains its peak is known as the overdrive voltage, which is nothing but gate to source voltage minus the threshold voltage, VGS minus VTH, which is also known as VOD, that is overdrive voltage. And this current, the amount of this current, the value of this current, we have also calculated in the last class. And that value, I can represent this one like half mu n C aux W by L. Let me just do one thing. Let me just use that part, because it's difficult to. Okay, let me use a different color so that it can be continued. So this is half mu n C aux W over L into VGS minus VTH whole square. So that is the peak value of the current, and you have already noticed that this peak current depends upon the mu n C aux, which is nothing but the technology dependent parameter, the W by L, that is related to the device dimension, and moreover this VGS minus VTH whole square, that means the overdrive voltage whole square. And as of now, we have seen that in this particular region, which is known as the saturation region, the drain current remains essentially constant and it is completely independent of the drain to source voltage. So in the last class, we have also identified two different regions of operations. So this region is known as the saturation region. This is known as the saturation region, where the drain current remains essentially constant with respect to the drain to source voltage. And this region is known as the triode region or the linear region, triode or linear region. So the amount of VDS, whether it is greater than the overdrive voltage or it is less than or equal to the overdrive voltage, ultimately decides in which region the MOS is there, MOS is operating. And accordingly, if you can remember once again, for your understanding, let me once again write it down, the expression for the current, that is ID is equal to, is given by mu n C aux W by L into VGS minus VTH into VDS minus half VDS square, which represents this parabolic behavior. And obviously, this is true when VDS is less than or equal to VGS minus VTH. And the value of ID is equal to half mu n C aux W over L into VGS minus VTH whole square whenever the VDS value is greater than VGS minus VTH. So this region is known as the triode region, which represents the first equation, and the saturation region is represented by the second equation. Now what you can see here, the value of ID varies with VGS minus VTH whole square in the saturation region, and in the triode region, it depends both on the overdrive voltage as well as on the drain to source voltage. Now, if you would like to find out the derivative of this particular curve, I mean the derivative of ID with respect to VDS, you will be having different values, and the reciprocal of this derivative will ultimately give you the notion of a resistance. Because if I observe this three-terminal device, if I just consider that between gate to source, we are providing a constant battery. Like, let me put a battery between these two. Let me consider, okay, I am having a MOS with three terminals, gate, drain, and source. And let us put a battery of fixed voltage between this gate and source. Let this voltage, let it be say V1. And between drain to source, I use something like this, which is a varying, maybe, like, let me use a different color. Yeah. So this current is ID, and the voltage between these two is VDS. So this particular voltage source, as has been shown over here, is a varying voltage source. That means it's not constant. Now, if I just observe, okay, this three terminal device as a two terminal one, with these two terminals are available like drain and source, then what about the voltage between these two terminals? What about the applied voltage? The applied voltage is VDS. And what about the current that is flowing through it? That is ID. So if I calculate the variation of VDS with respect to the variation of ID, then what we get is nothing but the resistance offered by this particular device. So 1 upon delta ID by delta VDS will give you the value of the resistance as offered by this particular device. Now that is easy to calculate because now you have the closed form expression of ID, which can be represented as a function of VDS. So ID is given by this one. So now if you just find out this delta ID upon delta VDS, which is nothing but the reciprocal of the resistance, that is equal to mu n C aux W by L into VGS minus VTH, when the value of VDS is much, much less as compared to 2 times VGS minus VTH. And that condition we have already mentioned in the last class, that condition is satisfied in the deep triad region. And here you find, if you just calculate the reciprocal of this, 1 upon delta ID by delta VDS, then it is nothing but 1 upon mu n C aux W by L into VGS minus VTH. So therefore, we find that as long as VDS is much, much less than 2 times VGS minus VTH, and if you change the value of VDS, there is no change in the value of the resistance. Resistance remains constant because the resistance is not a function of VDS under this condition. It's only a function of VGS minus VTH. So you can calculate this resistance. So if I call this resistance to say R on, then this R on is nothing but 1 upon delta ID by delta VDS, and that is equal to 1 upon mu n C aux W over L VGS minus VTH. Now if VGS equal to VTH, when the gate to source voltage is exactly equal to VTH, then obviously the resistance will be equal to infinite, because that is the situation when the channel is just created. And obviously this condition holds good if VGS is greater than or equal to VTH, because until and unless the channel is created, you cannot write this equation. So the first and the second equation is can only be written if the amount of the gate to source voltage is greater than the threshold voltage, or at least equal to the threshold voltage. Otherwise you cannot write down these equations, because if the channel is not created, then there is no provision of current flowing. So when VGS is exactly equal to VTH, then the channel is just created, and then the resistance between the drain to source terminal can be considered to be infinite. However, if VGS just exceeds VTH, the threshold voltage, then we find that the on resistance, R on, is given by the reciprocal of this overdrive voltage, 1 upon VGS minus VTH, and that is intuitively correct also. Because if you increase the gate to source voltage, then obviously there will be more amount of electrons in the channel. I mean, the electron density, electron concentration in the channel region will be more. And accordingly, you find that the resistance between these two parts, I mean, the resistance between the drain and the source terminal, will be reduced. So as you increase the VGS, then the on resistance will be reduced. But here we find that the on resistance is entirely independent of the drain to source voltage. So in this particular region, when the drain to source voltage is much, much less than 2 times overdrive voltage, then we can utilize the MOS as a resistance. And moreover, the resistance of this particular device can be controlled by changing the value of VGS. That means the gate to source voltage. So the MOS can be employed as a voltage control resistor in this particular region. However, if you increase the value of VDS beyond this range, then obviously you find that then the amount of the resistance is no longer constant with respect to VDS, because now you have the dependence on VDS, and accordingly you find that the parabolic behavior is obtained. Now what happens beyond this point? What happened beyond this point VOD, that is overdrive voltage? Now here you find that the drain current is remaining constant, essentially constant, and today we will see that it is not exactly constant. And how is it so? We'll also explain this one. But as of now, we have seen that the drain current is essentially constant beyond overdrive voltage. When the drain to source voltage is greater than the overdrive voltage. So therefore, if you just calculate the slope del ID by del VDS, that will be equal to zero in the saturation region. So if you just calculate the corresponding resistance R on, then this R on will become infinite. But having an infinite value of R on in this particular case is completely different from what we have got for VGS less than VTH. Because under this condition, when the drain to source voltage exceeds overdrive voltage, then the device is on. Device is on and it is providing a constant current. The amount of current is essentially constant. So therefore, in this saturation region, we can utilize the MOS as an ideal current source. As of now, we can say ideal current source because the resistance offered by this particular device is found out to be infinite. But later on, you will see that this behavior is exactly not same. I mean, beyond VOD, beyond this overdrive voltage, the amount of ID is not exactly constant. However, it will increase slightly. We'll be definitely discussing what is the reason behind this particular kind of behavior. So these are the things that we have already discussed in the last two lectures. So taking these things into consideration, let us start today's discussion with a lemma. Now it says that, let me take a different color. It says that a MOS device turns on in saturation region always when the drain to source voltage is greater than zero. So already you have seen that there are two different regions of operations. One is known as the triode region or linear region, and second one is known as the saturation region. Now this property says that we will definitely prove this particular property, whether it is true or not. It says that MOS device turns on in saturation region always when the value of VDS is greater than zero. Now already we have shown two different equations. This first equation is for triode. This first equation is for triode region. And this equation is for saturation. The second equation is for saturation. And we have already seen that at the boundary, that means when VDS value exactly equal to VOD, the overdrive voltage, then the amount of current obtained from the triode region and amount of current obtained from the saturation region being the same. So there is no discontinuity over here at VDS equal to VOD. Now these two equations will tell us that whether we can use this particular device in the triode region or in the saturation region based upon this particular comparison. If VDS is greater than VOD, we will be using the device in saturation. If VDS is less than VOD, then we will be utilizing the MOS in the triode region. But to understand whether the device exactly is in saturation or is in triode, that can be calculated or that can be evaluated based on the voltage difference between these two, I mean VDS and VGS. Already we have seen that if the value of VDS, we have seen that if the value of VDS is greater than VGS minus VTH, then we are in saturation. And if VDS is less than VGS minus VTH, then we are in triode. And accordingly, we will be utilizing any of these two equations. So this is the symbolic representation of MOS. This is the gate terminal. This is the drain terminal. This is the source terminal. Now, whenever this MOS is employed in any of the electronic circuits, analog circuits, then we have to check out of these two conditions, which one is true. You can always calculate the voltage difference between the drain to source terminal, I mean VDS. You can always calculate the voltage difference between the gate and source terminal, that is VGS. And VTH is given for a fixed MOS. So therefore, you need to calculate VGS minus VTH, that is overdrive voltage, VOD. And then you have to compare this VOD with respect to this VDS, the drain to source voltage. If drain to source voltage is found out to be higher than VOD, then the MOS in saturation, and you use the second equation. And if the drain to source voltage is less than VOD, then the MOS is in the triode region, and you use the first equation, the equation corresponding to the triode region. Now, this particular lemma says the MOS device always turns on in saturation region when VDS greater than zero. Now we have to prove or disprove this particular statement. We have to check whether this statement turns out to be correct or incorrect. Now the statement says that the device turns on in saturation region always. So first of all, we have to identify when does the device turn on. For a MOS device, when can it be turned on? Now this can be obtained from our basic understanding that if the value of VGS is less than VTH, if this condition is true, then the device is off. And if VGS, the gate to source voltage, is greater than or equal to VTH, then the device is on. So the device is on when gate to source voltage is greater than or equal to the threshold voltage. So therefore, when the device just turns on, then what we find is when the device, so let me write it down. Just turns on, it implies that VGS just exceeds the threshold voltage. That means VGS exceeds VTH by some amount, however small it may be. So under this condition, what we find, VGS minus VTH just exceeds zero. And what is that? VGS minus VTH? VGS minus VTH is nothing but VOD, that is overdrive voltage. So when the device turns on, then the value of VOD is just greater than zero, slightly higher than zero. And as the amount of VGS is increased, then the overdrive voltage is also increased accordingly. Now to check whether the device is in saturation or in triode, you have to compare VDS with VOD. You need to compare VDS, the drain to source voltage, with the overdrive voltage. Now, if the drain to source voltage is greater than the overdrive voltage, then the device is in saturation, and if it is less than the overdrive voltage, then the device is in triode region. Now, already we have maintained a fixed value of VDS which is greater than 0. VDS is greater than 0. We have already mentioned that VDS is greater than 0, maybe 0.5 volt, 0.8 volt, 0.9 volt, whatever it may be, just greater than 0. And when the device just turns on, then the VOD is equal to 0, and then ultimately it exceeds 0. So the moment when the device just turns on, then the overdrive voltage is exactly equal to 0, and then VDS is greater than VOD. And as you increase the gate to source voltage, then what you find is the value of VOD, the overdrive voltage, is also increased accordingly. However, the VDS is remaining constant if you do not change the value of VDS, if you keep it a fixed value. Then initially, as you increase VGS in order to turn on the device, initially this particular condition holds good. So this holds good initially. And as you increase VGS, this will also increase overdrive voltage. Then a point will come when VDS becomes less than VOD. Finally, if VGS is increased, then ultimately point will come when VOD exceeds VDS. Now in this entire analysis, we are assuming that the drain to source voltage VDS is kept at a constant value, which is greater than 0 volt. So from this analysis, we can prove that a MOS device always turns on in saturation region whenever the amount of VDS is greater than 0. Now we will be utilizing this particular thing for a subsequent discussion. Now already in this first slide, we have shown the variation of ID with respect to VDS, but from these two equations, it is quite apparent that the value of ID significantly depend upon the value of VGS, I mean the gate to source voltage. And last we have seen that if we reduce the value of VGS, then the peak value of ID is also minimized, and obviously the overdrive voltage is also reduced. What I mean to say is that we have drawn anyway, so let me just change the color to some new one. So like that we have already established in the last class. This is for a new VGS and a lower VGS. Or lower VGS minus VTH, I should say. And accordingly, this value is also small. So it suggests that the value of ID essentially depends upon the gate to source voltage also. And in lecture one, we have analytically explained that if the amount of VGS increases, then the drain current will also increase. But that time we were not quite sure about the variation of this ID with respect to VGS. What we know is that if we increase the value of VGS, the ID will increase, obviously. But the shape and the form maintaining which the ID will increase is not obtained that time. So that we can establish today. So we have VGS as the independent variable and the drain current as the dependent variable. Now, how does it look like, this ID VGS graph? Already we have seen the variation of ID with respect to the VDS. Now, if VGS varies, then how does this ID vary with VGS? That is important. Now in lecture one, we have already mentioned that if the amount of VGS, the gate to source voltage, is less than the threshold voltage, obviously there is no question of current flow because there is no channel created. So as a matter of fact, what we can find is up to VTH, if this is my VTH, the threshold voltage up to this point, there is no current. And after that, if the amount of VGS, the gate to source voltage, exceeds the threshold voltage, then the drain current will increase. But now we have to identify how does it increase, following which equation it increases. So to answer this question, we have to take the help of this particular statement, which says that the MOS device turns on in saturation region always when VDS is greater than zero. So here you see, if the value of VGS is less than the threshold voltage, then the device is off. And if the value of VGS just exceeds the threshold voltage, then the device just becomes on. So now you have two equations for you. One is the variation of ID with respect to both VGS and VDS, which is nothing but the equation corresponding to the triode region. And second one is the variation of ID with respect to VGS. That means the equation corresponding to the saturation region. Now, when the gate to source voltage just exceeds the threshold voltage, out of these two equations, we have to take the help of the second equation, which says that ID is given by half mu n C ox W by L into VGS minus VTH whole square. We cannot use the first equation because we know that beyond this point, the device turns on in saturation region. And the equation says that ID varies proportionately with respect to VGS minus VTH whole square. So therefore, this variation, ID versus VGS variation, is a parabolic variation initially. It's a parabolic variation, it will follow this particular graph. Now, since it's a parabolic variation, so accordingly, you can also calculate the variation of ID with respect to VGS that we have done last time for ID with respect to VDS. And that is ultimately giving us the notion of a resistance. And we have seen that in the triode region or in the deep triode region, this resistance is remaining constant for a fixed VGS. And in the saturation region, this particular resistance is becoming infinite. Similarly, we can also calculate the variation of this ID with respect to VGS. That means del ID upon del VGS. So mathematically, if we just perform this derivative operation, then what we get is half mu n C ox W over L VGS minus VTH whole square. So this is very simple. This is nothing but mu n C ox W by L into VGS minus VTH. Now, what is that term called? Del ID upon del VGS. Now, in first lecture, I have already mentioned that MOS is a particular kind of device for which the drain current varies with respect to the gate to source voltage. So it's ultimately, it's a voltage controlled current source. So the basic operation of the MOSFET can be visualized as a current source. If I observe the behavior of the MOS in the saturation region, so ultimately it acts like a current source, a constant current source as of now, ideal current source as of now, and the magnitude of which depends upon the gate to source voltage. If I use a higher value of the gate to source voltage, then we have a much larger value for the drain current. If I use a relatively lower value for the gate to source voltage, we will be getting a relatively smaller value for the drain current. So the variation of this ID with respect to VGS, this del ID upon del VGS. So once again, you see, in the numerator, you have current. In the denominator, you have a voltage. So if you just calculate this particular thing, unit wise, this will give you the unit of a conductance, because current upon voltage. So unit of a conductance, and moreover, the current here is the output current that we get from the drain terminal itself, and the voltage is nothing but the input voltage, the voltage that is applied between the gate to source. So this del ID by del VGS gives you the variation of the output current with respect to the input voltage. So one terminal, I mean, in the numerator you have a current, in the denominator you have a voltage, that's fine. So it gives rise to the notion of a conductance. And in numerator you have the parameter, a variable associated with the output circuit, and in the denominator you have a parameter or variable associated with the input circuit. So it's conductance, and it is known as mutual conductance or transconductance, because one parameter is obtained at the input side, the other parameter is evaluated at the output side. So ultimately this thing is known as the mutual conductance or transconductance. You have already seen this kind of expression. I mean, this variable is not new to you. If you have studied the bipolar junction device, bipolar junction transistor, there also we have got a term like GM, which is nothing but the variation of the collector current with respect to the base voltage, del IC by del VB. So here we have del ID by del VGS, and this is known as the transconductance or mutual conductance. So this is known as mutual conductance, mutual conductance or transconductance. And this transconductance or mutual conductance plays a very vital role in identifying how strong the device is. That means for a given value of VGS, for a fixed value of VGS, if the value of GM is large, then obviously the corresponding change in the drain current is also large. That means if I want to segregate the different MOS device in terms of their strength, we can have this particular parameter, which is known as the mutual conductance, based on which we can segregate them. So for a given value of VGS, if the value of GM is large, if the mutual conductance is large, then the corresponding output current will also be large for that particular device. Now already we have seen one expression for GM, which is equal to mu n C aux W by L VGS minus VTH. So here you see that GM, that means the mutual conductance, varies linearly with this W by L ratio if VGS minus VTH is constant. And at the same time, it also varies proportionately with VGS minus VTH if W by L is constant. Because we have already assumed that mu and C aux, this is remaining constant as far as the fabrication of the circuit is concerned, fabrication of the device is concerned, because mu n is the mobility of the electron and C aux is nothing but the oxide capacitance per unit area. So as far as for a fixed fabrication technology, this mu n C aux is remaining constant. So what we can do is we can change the gate to source voltage, because threshold voltage is also constant for a fixed technology. So if I just change the gate to source voltage, then the GM will be large. If I increase the VGS, GM will be large for a fixed value of W by L. So this is one expression which can relate GM with W by L and VGS minus VTH. Now we can also write GM like twice ID upon VGS minus VTH. Now if you just compare these two expressions, equation number one, equation number two, you will wonder why. Because in one case you will see that GM varies proportionately with this overdrive voltage, and in other case you will see that GM varies inversely with this overdrive voltage. I think you can understand from where this particular equation is coming, because already we have found that IT is given by half mu n C aux W over L VGS minus VTH whole square. So if I multiply, if I put 2 over shear, and if I divide this entire expression by VGS minus VTH, what we have is mu n C aux W over L VGS minus VTH. That is nothing but GM, and which is equal to twice ID by VGS minus VTH. So in one case, you find that VGS minus VTH is linearly dependent with GM. In other case, you will see that GM varies inversely with VGS minus VTH. Now, where is the flaw? Now, to understand this particular thing, you have to follow this equation. This equation, ID is given by half mu n C aux W over L VGS minus VTH whole square. Now, as I've already told you, these two parameters, mu and C aux, product of these two is completely fabrication dependent. So we assume that this mu and C aux is a constant term over here. So what we can control is, we can control W over L, we can control VGS minus VTH, and we can also control ID. Even we cannot control VTH, VTH is also fixed. We can only increase or decrease VGS. That means the gate to source voltage. So in the first equation, we find that GM varies proportionately with W over L and with VGS minus VTH. And that is intuitively satisfying. Why? If I consider that, okay, W by L is fixed, suppose W by L is also fixed, W by L, that is the width by length, that particular ratio, if W by L ratio is fixed, then if I provide, or if I increase the value of the gate to source voltage, if VGS is increased, then what happens? So let me just draw the two-dimensional view of a MOS device, which looks something like that. It's a two-dimensional view. You have a drain region, you have a source region, you have a gate, you have a substrate. This is the gate terminal. So let me just use a different color. So this is gate, this one is source, this one is drain, and we have applied some voltage over here. So let us apply some voltage, some positive voltage over here, VGS, and this one is N plus, this one is also N plus, drain and source region, and this entire thing is fabricated on a p-type substrate. And as you know, this is my oxide layer. Now suppose this width and the length, so obviously you have a certain width of this particular gate, and there is a particular channel length. So for this timing, let us assume that this W by L is remaining constant. Okay, so now if you increase this gate to source voltage, then what happens? You have more number of positive charge in this plate, you have more number of negative charge in this channel region. So as you increase the gate to source voltage, so for this timing, let us assume that this drain to source voltage is remaining constant. VDS is remaining constant, and we are increasing the gate to source voltage. Now what happens if you increase the gate to source voltage, keeping everything constant, W by L and all, if you keep everything constant, and if you go on increasing the gate to source voltage beyond the threshold voltage, then you have more number of electrons in the channel region. Or in other words, the electron concentration in the channel region will go on increasing. So as this increases, therefore the resistance between the drain to source region will reduce, and accordingly, you have the more amount of current. So for this kind of device, if you increase the VGS value, that is the gate to source voltage, keeping drain to source constant, if you increase the gate to source voltage, what happens? You can have more amount of ID, because there will be a higher concentration of electrons in the channel region. So automatically, this transconductance will also increase. On the other hand, if you keep this VGS constant, VGS fixed, that means overdrive voltage fixed, And if you increase W by L, what happened? GM will also increase. Why? Because if you increase W by L, that means suppose you keep L constant and you increase the width of the device. So if you increase the width of the device, keeping L constant, then what happens? You have a more number of electrons available for the current conduction. There also, you'll find that the corresponding mutual conductance will also increase. However, in the second equation, what we find is, we find that GM varies inversely with VGS minus VTH. How is this possible? In this particular case, we find that GM varies linearly. It's directly proportional to VGS minus VTH, and here it is inversely proportional to VGS minus VTH. How is this possible? So in the first case, we find GM varies linearly with VGS minus VTH when W by L is constant. Now, if W by L is constant and if VGS minus VTH, this overdrive voltage, increases, so from this equation, it is quite apparent that ID will also increase. Because ID is given by half mu n Cox W over L into VOD whole square. Now, if W by L remains constant and if you go on increasing VGS minus VTH, then what happens? The ID value will also increase. Now, in the second case, what we find is GM varies inversely with VGS minus VTH. Now, while I write this equation, you must remember here you have another parameter, that is ID. And I can only write GM varies inversely with VGS minus VTH when ID is constant. If ID is not constant, then you cannot write VGS in this particular form, I mean GM in this particular form. Now here ID is constant. Now how can this be possible? ID is constant, and it says that, it suggests that if ID is constant and if VGS increases, then GM will drop down. Now, for a constant ID, if VGS increases, then obviously W by L will drop down. So if ID is constant, and we increase this one, VGS minus VTH, if this one increases, then it implies W by L must reduce to keep ID constant. Similarly, you can also represent GM as a function of ID and W by L. How can this be possible? So you have only three parameters which you can control. One is ID, second one is W by L, and the third one is this overdrive voltage VGS minus VTH. And these three parameters are interdependent with each other as obtained from this particular equation. So in equation number one, we have represented GM as a function of W by L and VGS minus VTH. And in the second equation, we have represented GM as a function of ID and VGS minus VTH. Now, you can also represent GM as a function of ID and W by L. How is this possible? You can represent, you can just substitute the value of VGS minus VTH over here. So what is VGS minus VTH from this expression? We find that VGS minus VTH, this is nothing but square root of 2ID upon mu n Cox W over L. Now, if you substitute this value over here, if you substitute this value over here, 2ID upon VGS minus VTH, then what we have is nothing but 2id divided by this entire thing, 2id upon mu n c ox w over l, and ultimately this will give us root over of 2id mu n c ox w over l. So this equation represents gm as a function of id and w by l. So here we find that from the third equation we find that gm varies with the square root of w by l. First equation says that gm varies linearly with w by l, directly with w by l. And this third equation, all of them are equivalent to each other. Third equation says that gm varies with the square root of w by l if and only if id is constant. So you cannot say whether gm varies linearly or inversely or with square root or with square absolutely until and unless you know what about the status of the other parameters, because there are three parameters which are involved or interconnected by means of this particular expression. Id is equal to half mu n c ox w over l vgs minus vth whole square. So the value of gm can be represented as a function of two parameters, either w over l and vgs minus vth, or id and vgs minus vth, or id and w over l. And depending upon the relative status of the other parameter, you can ultimately come to a conclusion. However, if the status of the other parameter is known, you can directly identify what about the relation between gm and with the other two parameters. Well, so this particular graph, as I have already mentioned, shows the variation of id with respect to VGS, that is the gate to source voltage. And already in the previous lecture, we have identified the variation of ID with respect to VDS. But that time we have made one approximation. And today we will be discussing that thing in detail. What the approximation we have done that time? If you can remember, the governing equation for us to calculate this IDVD characteristics, IV characteristics for a MOSFET was something like this. We have got a situation like this, ID dx is given by, or integration ID dx is given by integration mu n C ox W into VGS minus VTH into VGS minus VTH minus Vx to dVx. Now the limit of integration was from 0 to L for x, and for Vx was from 0 to VGS minus VTH. Assuming that when the value of Vx is becoming VGS minus VTH. So hopefully you can understand what is meant by Vx. So if not, let me once again show you. The corresponding description for Vx. So Vx is nothing but the local potential across the channel. So So this is the oxide layer. You have a gate potential over here. Source, drain. And we have identified this to be the beginning of the channel and this to be the end of the channel. This corresponds to x is equal to 0 and this corresponds to x is equal to L. And we have got a profile of electron concentration, something like this. As you increase the value of VDS, then this point at which the channel ceases to exist will come down from the drain towards the source end. And this point is known to be the pinch off point, as you know. This is known to be the pinch off point. This is the pinch off point where Vx is equal to Vgs minus Vth. So Vx is nothing but the local potential inside the channel. So here you find Vx is equal to 0 because source is connected to the ground terminal, and here you find Vx is becoming Vgs minus Vth when the pinch off point is achieved. And this is the corresponding distribution of the electrons. You have more number of electrons towards the source end and you have lesser number of electrons in the drain end. So that time we have made one approximation. It was said that if the value of drain to source voltage is greater than the gate to source voltage minus the threshold voltage, I mean if VDS is greater than the overdrive voltage, then the channel pinches off, and accordingly we cannot write down this expression like this, because now the length of the channel is not from 0 to L, rather it is from 0 to some L dashed. 0 to L dashed, where I can write this L dashed as L minus some delta L. But while calculating that expression, we have simply ignored this delta L. We have assumed that, okay, the value of L is much larger, so that with respect to this L, I can simply neglect this delta L. So if the length of the channel is large enough for the large channel device, the value of delta L can be simply ignored with respect to L. So although the integration limit should be from 0 to L dashed, but we have integrated this entire expression from 0 to L, assuming that delta L can be neglected with respect to L. However, if you calculate the thing much more precisely, then that particular approximation cannot be done. Now, initially, when the length of the channel was large enough, then this approximation was valid. And the scientists have got fairly acceptable result. But as the day progresses, with the development of VLSI design, what happened is the length of the channel is reduced significantly. And when the length of the channel, I mean the L value, is reduced to a certain extent, then a point has come when you cannot simply neglect this delta L with respect to L. In other words, we have already obtained these IDVD characteristics like this. Already I have shown you this graph. It was something like that. It was fairly constant beyond this magical number VGS minus VTH, that is overdrive voltage, VOD. This is 0 and this is the ID peak. Now that expression, if you can remember, that expression was half mu n C aux W over L VGS minus VTH whole square. Now the thing is that this expression is not valid if you reduce the value of L. What happens is if you reduce the value of L for the short channel devices, scientists have obtained a different variation of ID with respect to VDS beyond this pinch off point. What they have obtained is the amount of ID increases slightly with respect to VDS. So they have noticed that this particular equation is not valid. This half mu n C aux W over L VGS minus VTH whole square, and the current is remaining constant at this value. So this is not valid if you go on reducing the value of L. A point will come when you find that this current beyond this pinch off point is no longer remaining constant. Rather, it increases with VDS. Then ultimately they have to identify what is the reason behind this. Why does the current increase beyond this particular point? Then ultimately they have come to the point, okay, they have made some approximation over there. The approximation, the previous approximation was that, previous approximation, it was like, delta L can be ignored so that L dashed is almost equal to L. So we should integrate it from 0 to L dashed, but they have integrated this expression from 0 to L. But this is not correct. What they have obtained for a short channel device. Then we need to re-evaluate this integration, and it will be something like that. It will be x is equal to 0 to L dashed id dx, that is equal to integration, here the limit of Vx is from 0 to VGS minus VTH, that is the limit of integration. And we have mu n C aux W over L VGS minus VGS minus VTH minus VX minus VX into DVX. So if you just compute this integration, everything will be same. The only difference is that you have, instead of L dashed L, you have L dashed now. So half mu n C aux W over L dashed VGS minus VTH whole square. So now it will be better to represent this L dashed in terms of L. So this L dashed, or what we can write is, that is same as half mu n C aux W over L into VGS minus VTH whole square into L by L dashed. Now we have to observe this particular parameter, L upon L dashed. So what is that L upon L dashed? So L upon L dashed is nothing but L upon L minus delta L. That is equal to 1 divided by, so if you just divide both the numerator and the denominator by L, then it becomes 1 minus delta L by L. So 1 upon 1 minus delta L by L. So that is nothing but 1 minus delta L by L whole to the power minus 1. So being at a power series, so what we can do is 1 minus x whole to the power minus 1, you know that 1 plus x square plus x cube dot dot. So it will be continued like this. Now once again they have made an assumption. So here they have assumed that, okay, delta L cannot be neglected completely. It cannot be ignored. We can't make delta L is equal to 0 as we have done before. so that L dash was equal to L. But what we can assume is delta L is small enough so that this delta L by L ratio can be computed up to a power of 1. So 1 minus x whole to the power minus 1, that can be approximated. So 1 minus x whole to the power minus 1, that can be approximated to be 1 plus x only. So that the higher order terms like x square, x cube, x to the power 4 and so on, they can be neglected simply. So then ultimately what we have is 1 plus delta L upon L. 1 plus delta L upon L. But the problem is, how can you relate this delta L with respect to this drain to source voltage? Because you understand here that, okay, let me just go to the next slide and let me once again write it down what we have obtained so far. That is ID is equal to half mu n C ox W over L VGS minus VTH whole square into 1 plus delta L by L. So what is delta L? So let me just show you symbolically. Let me just show you the channel side only. So this is all about the electron concentration, distribution of the electrons in the channel region. This is the source end, this is the drain end. And this length was L. And the length from here to here is delta, is your L dashed. And this length is nothing but delta L. So as you increase the potential at this particular point, so if you increase VDS, then obviously this pinch off point will move towards the source end. So as you increase VDS, what happens? This delta L will also increase. That means this L dash will go on decreasing. Right? So we can understand that delta L and VDS, they can be related in a linear fashion. Because as delta L increases, we understand that this is because of an increase in VDS. So this particular expression delta L by L, which is nothing but an unitless quantity delta L by L. So this delta L by L can be written to vary linearly with VDS, that is the drain to source voltage. Because you know, for a fixed value of L, if you go on increasing VDS, then the delta L will reduce further. So delta L and VDS, they can be related in a linear fashion like this. Now this delta L by N, being a unitless quantity, so what we can do is delta L by L can be written as VDS multiplied with some constant, which is equal to lambda, and the unit of lambda is 1 upon fold, so that this lambda times VDS is becoming a unitless quantity. And then the expression for ID becomes like this, half mu n C ox W over L VGS minus VTH whole square into 1 plus, so delta L by L can be represented as a function of VDS, because the appearance of delta L over here is only because of a higher value of VDS. So now in the saturation region, you can have a dependence of VDS on the value of ID, a first order dependence. So half mu n C aux W over L VGS minus VTH whole square into 1 plus lambda VDS. And this entire phenomenon is a second order effect of a MOS device and is known as a channel length modulation. This is known as channel length modulation. Because as you increase the value of VDS, what happens is the length of the channel, the effective length of the channel is reduced from the drawn length. Previously it was L. As long as the length of the channel is large enough, then this delta L can be neglected with respect to this L. But as we are talking about some short channel device, a shorter value for L, then this delta L cannot be completely ignored with respect to L. So ultimately this ID VDS graph will look something like that. So let me just now show you how does the variation of ID will look like with respect to VDS in the saturation region. So that is up to this, it is fine. This is the point where the saturation begins, VGS minus VTH. And then instead of having a constant kind of thing, now it will, so now what I can do is I can show you this one. Two graphs like this. So now the current will increase. So this is considering this is considering channel length modulation. CLM in short. And this is without considering. Without CLM. So considering the channel length modulation, the current will increase. And as you can find out from this graph, that if you just calculate this one, del ID by del VDS, you can have a lambda dependent term over here. And that is ultimately giving you the slope of this particular graph. Okay. So now you have, once again, you have two regions of operations. One is the triode region or the linear region where the current increases by following a parabolic nature. Mu n C aux W over L VGS minus VTH into VDS minus half VDS square. The current increases in that way up to this point, up to this VGS minus VTH. This is the magical point. Beyond this point, so far we have seen that the current will essentially becoming constant. I mean, it's remaining constant. There is no dependence of ID on VDS. You find that, okay, it's remaining constant over here. And that value is like half mu n C aux W over L VGS minus VTH whole square. Now, if I just forget about the channel length modulation, then we are happy that the current is remaining constant and we can build an ideal current source using a MOS device in the operating in the saturation region. However, if this second order effect of MOS is taken into our consideration, that if we increase the value of VDS, then delta L will also increase. And for a short channel device, this increase of delta L is severe enough, is significant enough, so that we cannot simply neglect the impact or contribution of this delta L on the value of ID. So accordingly, we have modified the expressions of ID, and where ID is given by half mu n C aux W over L VGS minus VTH whole square multiplied with this correction factor, which is nothing but 1 plus lambda VDS. And from that, you'll find that now, under this condition, with CLM, that is the channel length modulation in short, with CLM, delta ID by delta VDS is non-zero, is not equal to zero. That means there is a slope, there is a finite slope. And without CLM, without channel length modulation, delta ID upon delta VDS is equal to zero. That means it gives rise to an ideal current source. Because since delta ID upon delta VDS is equal to zero, that means 1 upon delta ID by delta VDS will become infinite. That means the resistance offered by the current source becoming infinite, as you know. So we can build ideal current source without considering the channel modulation. And here, although large, here also you'll find that the corresponding 1 upon the slope will be large. Slope is not that much. Slope is small here, and 1 upon slope will be large. That means even if you consider the channel in modulation, the corresponding inverse of the slope will be large enough, but that is not exactly called infinite. So you cannot build ideal current source using this CLM model. Rather, what you can do is you can build non-ideal current source. Ideal current source means R out, that means the output resistance of the current source is equal to infinite. And non-ideal current source means R out is finite but large. And that can be governed by the value of lambda over here, where lambda is known to be the channel length modulation coefficient, CLM coefficient in short. So from today's discussion, what we can ultimately summarize is the drain current for a MOS device depends on two parameters. One is known as the gate to source voltage. Second one is known as the drain to source voltage, which we can control from outside. Apart from that, it is having its dependence on the mobility of the charge carriers, the oxide capacitance, and the dimension of the device. Now, as far as the voltages are concerned, this can be controlled by VGS as well as by VDS. And accordingly, we can have the different variations of ID with respect to VDS in two different regions. In the prior region, it will follow the parabolic behavior. And if you consider the deep triad region, where the value of this drain to source voltage is very, very small with respect to the overdrive voltage, then this parabolic behavior can also be considered to be almost linear. And the corresponding slope is becoming constant. However, as the drain to source voltage increases, you have some non-ideal characteristics in the form of a parabola. And in the saturation region, if you just forget about the any kind of second order effect, then we can assume that the current will be constant. However, if you take into account the condition of a channel length modulation, which is significant for a short channel device, then you find that the current in the saturation region will also, the drain current will also depend on the value of VDS, that is the drain to source voltage, and it will increase as you increase the value of VDS or the drain to source voltage. And accordingly, you can build or you can utilize the MOS as an ideal current source when it operates in the saturation region without considering the effect of the channel length modulation. However, the non-ideal current source can also be built using a MOS device operating in the saturation region whenever you consider the channel length modulation into your account. So with this, I would like to conclude my today's discussion on the different properties of a MOS device, along with the variation of ID with respect to the different voltages, like gate to source voltage and the drain to source voltage.